Through the lobby and onto the narrow streets, it is the sound of clangorous bells and morning birds that welcome us, and more cows with long flapping ears, raw sewage, crumbling palaces and temples. Soon we find ourselves in a maze of alleyways, thick with the sweet, heady smell of incense. Varanasi is formed by any number of small corridors, back streets, and narrow passages, going back thousands of years. We don't use our phones for a map, but walk on with our senses. Everywhere in saris and colored robes, men and women with beautiful bindis carry fruits and incense, a kaleidoscope of color, a synesthesia of smells. The bindi is a dot or small particle of color placed on the forehead. It is one of seven areas of concentrated energy called chakras. The chakras run along the center of the body, and the sixth one called ajna, the ajna chakra, the brow chakra, or the third eye chakra. This is where the bindi is placed. In Sanskrit, ajna translates as command or proceed, and is considered the eye of intuition and intellect. According to the Vedas, when something is seen in the mind's eye or in a dream, it is also seen by ajna. The bindi's purpose is to enhance the powers of the chakra, specifically by facilitating one's ability to access their inner wisdom or guru. Hindu tradition holds that all people have a third inner eye. The two physical eyes are used for seeing the external world, while the third eye focuses inward towards one's intuition and the divine. As such, the red dot signifies piety, as well as serving as a constant reminder to keep God at the center of one's thoughts. Irina steps into a small shop to look at saris. I wait outside. The sights, sounds, colors take me up. I notice the light, and once again, my shadow is projected on a whitewashed cinema screen. There it is again, a silent cinema. And then, it disappears. I have disappeared, watching the cinema screen without projection. I stare into the bright light, until I hear her voice. Irina now wears an emerald sari, accentuating her green eyes. "Call me Shakti," she says. And so it was. Just the way she says it is so beguiling and incredible. As a vital cosmic force, Shakti takes many forms and names, including Mother Goddess, Fierce Warrior, and the dark goddess of destruction. In Hinduism, every god has a Shakti, or energy force, the warrior who conquers forces that threaten the stability of the universe. I walk along now with Shakti, rounding the winding alley. A slight breeze takes up her emerald sari, like a veil, where the sun shines through to the pearlescent sparkles sewn there, as she shimmers whiteness, a kind of UFO. I wondered, what was the secret, the spell of this profuse love I had for her? I was more than enchanted. In the iridescent spell of what appeared now as a goddess walking through the alleys of this city, of a thousand incarnations of gods. In this moment of love, a dream of total union with the loved being, everything is suspended, time, law, prohibition. It is the paradox of love that it seeks the union of two individuals while wanting to leave their individuality intact. It is said that the greatest proclivity to this consummation with the other is seen in religious devotion. Expansion of the self is a cardinal feature of the love for and submission to God. It is also observed in political extremism, where this paradox often destabilizes love, either through the lover's insistence on doing away with separateness through self-surrender, or through domination. It is a deranged interval, swaying between feelings of power and powerlessness. For a time, a dream of total union, and then, just a sudden, doubt as to the sincerity of this love. Both the ruler and the subject, the dominant and the submissive, conspire to clothe the nakedness of their relationship in the garb of love, a tension that is both intensely pleasurable and painful. Love is, by turns and in varying degrees, safe harbor and storm. The Vedic texts state that during the Satya Yuga, or the Golden Age, love can last some 100,000 years. The teachers and sages of the Upanishads had a profound realization. Atman, the inmost soul or breath of life, is also Brahman, the ultimate reality. While the Atman is the essence of an individual, Brahman is an unchanging universal spirit or consciousness which underlies all things. They are discussed and named as distinct from one another, but they are not always thought of as distinct. We walk along, our hands, our minds entwined into each other, Atman and Brahman, Shiva and Shakti. It was as if Shakti could feel the touch of my thoughts through her hands. The experience of merging with another person into such a state has been called dual unity. It is a transpersonal phenomenon characterized by a transcendence of the usual spatial limits of consciousness. The subject experiences various degrees of loosening and losing of ego boundaries and merging with another person into a state of unity and oneness. It is said that the Indian establishes her bliss in dispassionate repose, in an undisturbed enjoyment of serenity and peace. She swims in a sea of sweet dreams and invigorating fragrances. This is, to me, the feeling of love. My hand dreaming in hers. What is a dream but the idea that something is moving through us, pleasantly or unpleasantly inhabiting us? Perhaps, as William Blake stated, the imagination is not a state, it is human existence itself. When the Hindu says, everything is unreal, the Westerner reacts and says, no, we can't treat life as a dream. It's serious, it's real, it's for real. What do you mean by that? How real do you want it to be? Everything is falling apart. Everything is changing. Like the dancing morning mist now levitating above the Ganges River. At the top steps of the Ghat we sit, more pilgrims, beggars, lepers, cows, dogs, flower sellers. The word Ghat evolved from Sanskrit, means that part of a river or a pond where people bathe, clothes are washed, cattle drink water, or travelers willing to cross the water can pick up a ferry. The sky is unusually blue, with the mist now becoming cotton candy clouds. In those clouds, we see the shapes of the Himalaya mountains, glaciers cascading into the waters of the river Ganges. Life would be incomplete without bathing in this sacred river at least once in their lifetime, Hindus believe. To bathe in these waters is to stop the wheel of karma and the cycle of death and rebirth, the physical and emotional pain that it seems all humanity must make sense of to persist, to find its answers, its resolution, to be whole again, one with the divine. Beyond my astonished eyes was a stupefying profusion of human bodies. Laundry washing person beat the dirt out of the clothes. Buffaloes wallow, sadhus, holy men chant and pray. Monks with shaven scalps and rose-colored robes, their faces marked by the woe of the world, come and go, plunge into the water, and re-emerge as if coming out of their mother's womb, one day to enter the womb of death, but for a moment purified. I think I spot the tailor from the cab ride. There he is with his small hat and deep eyes. Yes, and the couple from the shop down from our pink palace. It's all quite ordinary in a way, quite banal, for those that live here, the river part of their everyday life. Amongst the citizens of the town are the pilgrims, who have come here from all walks of life, healthy, sick, rich, and poor. A Hindu woman bathes, dressed in a silk sari, her forehead adorned with a pinch of sindoor. There is something in her bathing, the way she cups the water and lets it slowly pour down her face and shoulders. She delights in watching the water, as if in slow motion as it rolls over her. Lila, like many Sanskrit words, cannot be literally translated to English, but can be loosely translated as play. Lila is a way of describing all reality, including the cosmos, as the outcome of creative play by the divine absolute. The slow, self-manifesting birth of God in matter is the purpose of the terrestrial Lila. She now stretches her arms outward, a look of ecstasy on her face as she calls out, Ganja Mahika. Long live Mother Ganja. Clearly, this is no ordinary river. The purpose of creation is Lila, she seems to be saying. Lila is a purposeless purpose. A natural outflow, a spontaneous self-manifestation of the divine. Lila, the concept of it, emphasizes the role of delight in creation, the bliss aspect of the divine. If the world is manifestation of the force of Satchitananda, the deployment of its existence and consciousness, its purpose, can be nothing but delight. This is the meaning of delight. Lila, the play, the child's joy, the poet's joy, the actor's joy, the mechanic's and chef's joy, the mercenaries, the psychopathic, the insane. All of this perpetually inexhaustible, creating and recreating himself in himself, for the sheer bliss of that self-creation, of that self-representation, himself the play, himself the player, himself the playground. All exist here, no doubt, for the delight and the horror of existence. All is a game, Lila, but a game too carries within itself an object to be accomplished. And without the fulfillment of that object, there would be no completeness or significance.